I think the thylacine is just an amazing animal in and of itself, but it played an absolutely critical role in the ecosystem in Tasmania. So in terms of why we might want to bring a species back, there are a lot of really good reasons why the thylacine should be top of everybody's list. It was an iconic animal that had this really critical role. It was our only apex predator that we ever had in marsupials in Australia. And so there's no other animal that can fulfill that space. We have really good DNA for it, which means we can do a really good job of bringing it back. And the ecosystem that it lived in still exists in Tasmania. So there's somewhere to actually put that animal when we bring this species back. This was unthinkable 10 years ago, but today we have all of the technologies we need to do this. It would just take a really long time to do it. And I think if these continue to move forward as quickly as they have in the past 10 years, we may be able to get there even quicker than a 10-year time frame. But I do think 10 years is quite reasonable to assume that we would be at the point of having a fully edited thylacine cell that we would then be looking at recreating whole animals from. So this is not patented, you know, this is something that we're doing because we genuinely want to be able to put these animals back into the wild. So this isn't something that, you know, you would have to buy a thylacine or could do it. These would be, the whole idea of this project is to rewild these animals across Tasmania. There will be technology that gets developed as part of this project that can be used and patented for other uses. But in the conservation space, this will always be used to just for the greater good and restoring lost biodiversity. None of the stuff that I'm working on is being done to have a financial gain or to sell animals or to create animals for a commercial gain. It's really about restoring lost biodiversity. One of the questions I get asked all the time is, do you have the complete genome? And the answer is yes, we do, but putting all of it back together is the bit that's really complicated. So we know what every bit looks like. We don't necessarily know where every little bit fits in the bigger piece of the puzzle that is the genome. And so that's what we're working, is to make sure we have that complete puzzle. And we're doing a lot of work right now to make sure we can really complete that entire sequence. And then the idea is to re-engineer this animal to be 99.9% a thylacine, so to do as many edits as we possibly can. And then at that level, you're looking at the same amount of diversity that you might see between you and me, for example, in our genomes. We have about 0.1% difference just between us, and that would be about the same level of difference that we would have for at that thylacine versus any other thylacine in the population. And so when we recreate it and we get to that level, I feel really comfortable saying that that is a thylacine, and that is the animal that, you know, would go back into the wild as the genuine species. Yeah, we've consulted both in Tasmania, but also really interestingly in the Northern Territory as well. One of the things that people don't often know about the Tasmanian tiger is it really isn't Tasmanian. It used to be across the entire of mainland Australia. And in fact, all the rock art that we know pretty much that exists for the Tasmanian tiger is in the northern part of Australia. And so we've spoken with groups up there and elders up there, also in Tasmania, and we're really passionate about involving them in the decision-making process around not just recreating the thylacine, but also the rewilding aspect of the thylacine, which is obviously some years down the track, but it's going to be really important to discuss, you know, how they feel about where these animals might go. And also it played a really fundamental role in some of the storylines from the First Nations people. And so really getting them engaged in it. So far, everybody's been really excited about the project and really positive about the possibility of one day returning this species to its native habitat again. This is a really great question, is how would it know it's a thylacine? Obviously, we've talked a lot in our lab and, you know, with the work that we're doing about how we would get to that first thylacine, we'd probably end up using a fat-tailed dunnart as the surrogate mum, which is a small mouse-sized marsupial. This is one of the amazing things about marsupials is they give birth to tiny, tiny babies. In fact, thylacines and that group of marsupials, because they're called the dasyurids, have the smallest babies of all the marsupials. So they're about the size of a grain of rice when they're born. So what that means is that even this little mouse-sized marsupial could actually give birth to a baby thylacine. Obviously, it's going to outgrow the pouch very quickly, but we could keep it in the pouch for a few days and then we'd have to hand rear it from that point on. But then how does that behaviourally impact that pouch young? Will that grow up and know that it's a thylacine? And this is a really interesting question that we have. And you can see this through a lot of ecology. A lot of people will hand rear orphaned cubs or animals from other, that bigger group of mammals, the placental mammals. And it does seem that they do have a lot of hardwired behaviours in their brain, particularly things like hunting behaviours are incredibly hardwired in an animal's brain. So we would think the animal would have an inherent knowledge of being able to take down prey, eat and survive in a particular environment. But again, I think you would want to breed the thylacines in captivity for a few generations to make sure that the thylacines that you actually might end up releasing into Tasmania were raised by other thylacines that had had a few generations to remember or to refine their place in that ecosystem and to learn how to hunt and, you know, however they interacted together, for that to come back again before you would have those animals that actually go off on their own into an ecosystem. This is a really great question too. So we're not talking about just bringing back one animal and then cloning it. We're actually sequencing the genomes of 50 Tasmanian tigers. So there's one of the other great things about the Tassie tiger is there's a lot of preserved material in museums all over the world. And so we are able to get a really good snapshot of what their diversity looked like and then engineering that diversity back into the genomes to make sure we have a healthy population that's not just going to survive but hopefully thrive once again in that ecosystem. We can actually engineer those changes and differences in. And looking at the diversity so far, we probably have to engineer about 40 different genotypes or 40 different animals to give us a really good healthy population that could really thrive. Absolutely, and I think most things in science don't work the first time, that we have to go through this process of learning about how we do this sort of work and how we change things and how we adapt things. But we're working with some of the biggest groups in the world that are also working on dodo de-extinction projects and the mammoth de-extinction project, and we're all sharing our ideas and advances that we're making in this space to make sure that we're learning from each other and we're doing this as efficiently as possible. But absolutely, I will keep doing this until we have our thylacine, and once we've got our thylacine, I'll start working on something else that we need to bring back. So definitely we will keep going on this. I think that all of these species have a role to play in a much broader ecosystem, and every single animal, including us, has a place in these giant webs. And then when we've come in as humans and we've exterminated groups of animals or a particular species like the Tasmanian tiger, when we've persecuted that animal and removed it so quickly, I think if we have the technology to bring those species back and to put them back into that environment, we really owe it to those species and those individuals to have that place back in the ecosystem once again. And so I think all of these animals play an incredibly valuable role. And if we have the technology to bring them back, I think we owe it to the species to bring them back. I'm 100% confident that we will be able to recreate species. This will be something that is going to happen much more commonly in the next 10, 20, 30, 40 years. And I think we really need to start as a community having discussions around what barriers or limitations we might want to put on the use of this technology, what species have been gone for too long to bring back, what are the rules around what's a great species to bring back versus one that's not so great to bring back. And I think that's a really important discussion we have to have, because the reality is we are very, very good at genetic engineering now. We are very good at cloning and creating animals. animals. And so this is just combining those two technologies together. There's nothing that we need to recreate the thylacine that we don't have in terms of technology. We have all of the technology to do it. It's just a really big job, and we're getting more efficient at how quickly we can do it. But it's certainly something that's going to happen. And once that becomes much easier and more tractable, once we can make DNA edits much faster, then it really opens up the floodgates of what sort of species we can bring back and how we want to use this technology thoughtfully, I think, to really protect the globe against big biodiversity losses. Yes, it's been much easier to bring back humans for a very long time than it is to do this sort of work. In fact, you know, we're very good at assisted reproductive technology. We know much more about how to create human embryos than we do anything else. So the human cloning thing has been around, you know, for a very long term in terms of the possibility of doing it. Obviously, ethically, we don't do it, and we wouldn't do it. So there's an ethical barrier there, but not actually a scientific barrier to doing that sort of work.